How does a ballistic missile defense system intercept an enemy missile? This is what I will try to answer in this episode, going over the basics and some of the more advanced parts of it. A ballistic missile is launched. Here, it is an advanced, medium-range ballistic missile with MIRVs or multiple independent re-entry vehicles, meaning that the ballistic missile has a range of 1,000 to 3,000 kilometers, and there are multiple warheads on the missile. Each can strike a different target. What happens next depends on the defense architecture. In this video, an American or European-like architecture is shown, engaging the hostile missile only with Aegis and early detection methods. SM-3, an exoatmospheric, highly capable ballistic missile interceptor. It has the 1A, the 1B, and the 2A variants. The 1B brought mainly an improved seeker and an improved divert and attitude control system, while the 2A increases the range, improves the seeker, and the divert and attitude control system. Satellite, equipped with infrared or heat sensor, detects the hot missile very early in its flight. With this information, the settings of the radars of the defense are tweaked to detect the enemy missile optimally. As the missile enters the detection range of the ANTPY-2 radar, the data is transferred to the Aegis ship stationed at the sea behind the ANTPY-2. An interception solution is calculated. The earlier the SM-3 is launched, the sooner the target will be intercepted, and thus the more likely it is that the Aegis will have an additional interception opportunity in case the first interceptor misses, significantly reducing the leakage rates. So even though the enemy missile hasn't entered the detection envelope of the SPY-1 radar stationed on the Aegis ship, an SM-3-1B is launched. Later, the target missile will enter the SPY-1's detection range. Around 7 seconds after launch, the first stage MK-72 booster burns out and the second stage starts burning. The second stage MK-104 dual fuel rocket motor takes the missile higher in the atmosphere. The second stage burns out while the missile is still inside the atmosphere. The third stage kicks in and takes the missile to space. The third stage has two pulses. Each one lasts about 10 seconds. Between the pulses, the SM-3 makes a pitch maneuver using the thrusters located on the back of the third stage. Note that the pitch maneuver doesn't change the direction in which the interceptors move. The nose cone is then ejected, and the missile turns back to the interception point, and the second pulse ignites. Ten seconds later, the second pulse burns out, and the missile turns towards the current position of the target to allow the IR seeker to acquire it. The KV is then separated and moves toward the target. The kill vehicle is basically the warhead of the missile. The TDAX, the throttling divert and attitude control system, comprises of 4 divert thrusters and 6 attitude control thrusters. The kill vehicle utilizes it to make course corrections and to keep the target in the seeker's field of view. The 2-color seeker acquires the target accurately. When close enough, the KV will determine where exactly to hit the missile. In order to ensure the destruction of the threat, the enemy ballistic missile was successfully destroyed. But what if the missile malfunctions and it fails to intercept? I think we can expect at roughly 10 to 20% of the intercepts. First of all, it might be that the same ship has enough time to launch an additional interceptor, but I want to show what happens if the missile gets over it. The bus, or the post-boost vehicle, flies towards the draw point of the re-entry vehicles and then releases 3 warheads, but not only the warheads. It also releases penetration aids. These are designed to make it harder to intercept the warheads, and most important are the decoys. In this scenario, the missile releases a number of simple mylar balloons, and two more sophisticated decoys. The mylar balloons were stored on the missile and are being inflated now, and those don't take up a lot of space. The mylar material has a radar signature, and those make it harder to determine how many interceptors must be launched. An infrared seeker is the one mounted on the kill vehicles of the SM-3, is capable of differentiating between the real warheads and the mylar balloons, where a single word discriminates. The two additional decoys are much more sophisticated, and are practically impossible to discriminate from the real warheads. While they also inflate as mylar balloons to not be as large as a real warhead, they are relatively large and only a few can be put on each missile. They have the same shape, size, heat, radar, etc. signature as the real warheads. The radar is tasked with discriminating between the decoys and parts that were detached from the bus as a result of the separation, for example metal parts, and the real warheads, as well as to overcome additional penetration aids as chaff. The same material planes use to defeat long-range air-to-air missiles. As mentioned above, the very sophisticated decoys are practically impossible to discriminate. The mylar balloons are likely to be discriminated successfully. 5 interceptors are launched towards the 3 MIRVs and 2 indistinguishable decoys from the Aegis ashore site. The defense doesn't know which are decoys and which are real MIRVs. Of course, that a real-life engagement is much more complex. A large number of ballistic missiles is likely to be launched. The defense architecture consists of many more radars and layers of interceptors, allowing for more interception opportunities, etc. This example gives a good idea of how good the ballistic missile defense system is. The interceptor intercepts all of the re-entry vehicles and all highly sophisticated decoys.